Hello, hello, Mr. KO. Hello.
Here we are.
Here we are.
Again.
Yeah, I actually look forward to revisiting the studio together. I loved being in your place in San Francisco, and especially now that spring is here and today is opening day, and you're right around the corner from the ballpark, or actually right up the street from the ballpark. We have to make this an experience.
As Jughead from Archie Comics might have said, spring is sprung, the grass is riz, I wonder where the flowers is.
Excellent. Excellent. John, dazzling us with some poetry this morning. Hey, everybody, welcome to Intersections. We are so excited to have you here every Thursday at 10:30 a.m. Pacific. Please do let us know where you're tuning in from. Let us know what is moving you and exciting you and inspiring you. What questions do you have? We've got some incredible guests, as always, today. And always interesting that they're friends. So we move in some interesting circles. And that's why we're here, to share our network with you and also to make you part of our community and us part of yours. So with that said, I'm going to kick things off formally because our first guest is already here backstage and he is a busy, busy individual. Welcome officially to Intersections, the weekly conversational jam session that dives deep into the intersections of technology, innovation, culture, and ideas. We always strive to bring diverse personalities and worldviews together in the service of greater understanding and unlearning. I'd like to introduce my co-host and friend, John KO. The Economist has called him Mr. Creativity and a serial innovator. You know, if you do any type of Googling on John, you see just how humbled we are to have him here with us. Just such an incredible background. He's taught at Harvard Business School. He served as visiting faculty at MIT Media Lab in Stanford. He's a Tony-nominated producer of film and stage. Wrote the best-selling book, Jamming the Art of Discipline and Business Creativity. He is the chair for the Institute of Large-Scale Innovation. You know, also, he owns three incredible concert grand pianos that are all in his loft. The background that you see behind John now is actually very real. Make sure to also follow his Forbes column and his social accounts on Twitter and LinkedIn. Mr. KO, welcome to Intersections.
Brian, thank you so much. And let me now reciprocate. Brian, I think, is the innovation twin that I was separated from at birth. We both share a passion for that subject. Brian has a day job, which is global evangelist for innovation at Salesforce, but his network obviously extends far beyond that. And interestingly enough, when you speak of networks, ours are, I think, equally diverse, but complementary. And so that is reflected in the personality of the show. Brian has been an authority on matters digital before it was even fashionable to talk about digital. And now digital and innovation, digital and marketing, digital and organizational transformation and business model transformation. These are the subject matters that he is a leader in, expressing it through books, through keynote speeches, workshops, and thought leadership across a broad palette of channels. So, Brian, here we are.
Sean, thank you. What a nice intro. I'm excited to bring up our first guest. He's a longtime friend, also someone that I've admired from afar, but also close up when I get to see him at events. He has been called one of North America's leading visionaries by Strategy Magazine. He's the founder of the Six Pixels Group. It's an advisory investing and content producing company that is focused on brands, commerce, community, and what's next. But he's also just someone who is always at the edge of what is next, and more so, he helps bring it along the bell curve, bringing his peers, fellow influencers, but also businesses that he works with into the fold. So with that, let's bring on Mitch Joel. Mitch, welcome. Welcome to Intersections.
Hey, good to see both of you. How are you?
Well, better now that you're here and watching Gregarious from behind the scenes play with these boxes. It's like musical chairs. But Mitch, What a pleasure it is to have you. I mean, I don't even know where to start, to be honest with you, because you and I have known each other over a decade at least.
Let's see if you could do some quick math here.
And that so much has happened in that time together. I think the last time I actually saw you in the real world was in San Diego, and that was a few years ago. So it has been an incredible world that has evolved since then. So John and I are going to pepper you with questions for the next 20 or so minutes, but I'd like to kick things off with just an overview, Mitch, of where we are before we get into specifics, where we are in this sort of cusp post-pandemic world. What has changed in the last year, and where do we need to be as we come out of this pandemic?
Small questions out of the gate, right, Brian? I appreciate that. You know, there was and probably still should be this concern about it being another Great Depression, whether it's a K recovery or a V-shaped recovery. You know, I don't necessarily know that the tale has been told, and I don't know that the tale has been told globally. I think it's going to fall out geographically. I think it's going to fall out by region and industry, and it's going to be really, really different. So instead of the Great Depression, I like to focus on something I call the Great Compression. And for people like the three of us, and probably people watching this and listening to this, they felt it. You know, my keynote prior to the pandemic felt like, oh, we got to do this. And then my same keynote that I gave during the pandemic was, we really got to get on this like yesterday. And it's that Great Compression. And the analogy I give is, you know, if you look at e-commerce was at about 15% of overall commerce spend prior to the pandemic. Of course, during the pandemic, it hit upwards of 60%. You know, now it's floating around. It's not going to go back to 15. And in the industry, which Brian and John, you know, really, really well, we have this vision of 30-30, that by 2030, we would hit 30% of overall commerce. And clearly we smashed that during the pandemic. And more importantly, what I think happens in these moments of great compression is that it's a way to understand that it's not going to go back, and it happens a lot faster and a lot quicker. So we had everybody from our K-1 kids up until our eldest of elderly, where we're slipping iPads under the elder care homes to connect to them, really get digitized. And in that great compression, a lot of things happen. And primarily, you know, my area is the intersection of brands, consumers, and technology. And I really do think that, you know, a habit takes 30 days to form. We're a year plus into this. Many people, including myself, will probably celebrate two birthdays out of multiple holidays still in this vaccine. The habits have been established. And so it's really going to be an interesting foray when we see what happens at the end. Are brands that were forced to innovate and do things differently going to maintain those lines? Are they going to go back to their old habits? Will consumer habits have changed so much that we're only going to want the new behaviors and habits? And a lot of these tales just haven't been told yet. And so in a world where people want to know which one is it, my general attitude is that we sort of have to hold both of these things in our brains at the same time. That famous, I think it was Mark Twain or F. Scott Fitzgerald had that quote of, we have to, you know, hold these two objects in our minds at the same time. And one of them is that we're forever changed, and things will be very different going forward. And one of them might be, well, we'll look back and go, those 2-3 years were crazy, and things will go back to the way they were. And the answer is, I think we have to build models for both.
I love that response. I think, you know, philosophically, if we go back to normal, we will have missed the lesson and the opportunity in all of this. And there is much that has changed, much that's going to continue to change. I think the humanity of it all is that it's really easy to want to find some sort of normal, some sense of comfort and routine. And that change has always been hard and always will be hard. But I wonder, because you have an opportunity to advise such incredible brands, also stay at the intersection of where consumer evolution is happening, and also with startup innovation, you know, where is the silver lining in change for people who have not really had to change at speed and scale over the last several decades, like they will probably have to do in 2021 and 2022? How are you helping them think differently coming out of this?
Well, I don't think so much think differently so much as that idea that it's been compressed, that this ability to sit on the sidelines and wait and see how it goes has really disappeared. It's evaporated. And I think the most shocking thing that I saw, I don't know how either of you feel, I'd love your insights on this, is the businesses that I thought would really struggle seem to be thriving. And some of the businesses that I thought could never, you know, could do great during this have really struggled. And that to me really demonstrated that often we can't see the future all that well. It also really demonstrated to me the privilege. And so we can look at things that happened, you know, whether it's Black Lives Matter, whether it's the Me Too movement, and on, that it's become very visible to all of us that things have to really change, and that that great compression, that accelerant has already been lit. And so I think when we talk about like, where do we really hone in on, to me, it's speed of change. Now, you and I, we've always spoken about this idea of speed of change, but right now, this isn't a choice. It's not an option. If you're not changed or speeding to change, it's over. You can no longer talk in this day and age about equality. You can no longer talk about bringing on different types of people onto your board. You got to show the receipts. And you do that by demonstrating that in the picture. And the picture is your picture of your management team. It's your C-level. It's your directors. All this talk and all of this sort of desire to slowly move ahead, gone. It is now. And that's how it's going to look for the near short while. And I would argue in a positive way. And I'd love to know what you think.
Well, I'll share with you some of my ideas. I love what you just said. I think there's a, for those who don't know, I've dabbled in the practice of digital anthropology for a good couple decades now. And I've never seen change exponentially like we've seen in the last year around two things that I'm calling Generation N or Generation Novel. It's cross-generational group that was one part digital first, not, you know, just whether they were millennials or just people like you and me who just live a digital first lifestyle. Then also the sudden digital customer, people who were in shelter in place or for their own health and safety just embraced digital. And also this idea of the somatic marker of COVID-19 itself, like you said, that there were behaviors, behavior shifts just because of new routines and new patterns, but also the emotional bookmark that has forced us in many ways to think about the meaning of life, question our values, question success, question happiness. What is it that we're going to, who is it that we're going to be, and who do we want to become coming out of the pandemic versus what we came into this pandemic? And it's a really inspiring time, if you care about other people, to learn from those insights to build a more relevant business, to build a more socially responsible and sustainable business or organization, and to have insight into where to deliver value within the world. And I think with that said, I also want to make sure that we bring Mr. Kao into the conversation. And John, I think a good place to jump in here would be to sort of continue on what you're seeing as well, based on what Mitch had left us with. But then at some point before we let you go, Mitch, I want to set the stage for a conversation that it sounds like we're going to have at a later date around what has changed in terms of intimacy, connectivity, and the role that audio is now starting to play in sure. this world. So I'll tease that for later, but John, over to you.
Well, this is really an interesting lead-in to, I think, rewinding a bit to the notion of a taxonomy that you raised a few minutes ago, where the spectrum of compression related to people who, let's say, were looking to return to some notion of normal versus people who are forging ahead. And, you know, this notion of speed to adoption has been a part of marketing theory for the longest time. I mean, if you look at the traditional adoption curve, you know, you've got the pioneers, the early adopters, the, you know, the big middle, the laggards, and then, you know, I guess, you know, what's after that? What I've noticed is, in a sense, the extreme of not just nostalgia, but magical thinking, which we've all seen in the form of conspiracy theory, QAnon, and just outright denial. And so I'm interested in your thoughts about this notion of the taxonomy. It's not either or, it's both and, but it's both and, I would think. And the need for some fresh thinking about it, because each one of these kind of subdivisions is going to need a particular kind of help, you know, whether it be deprogramming or, you know, adjusting to the new tempo in this era of compression, as you call it. So what are your thoughts about that, Mitch?
You know, one is, it is a moment of extremes. And I think that we have to be able to start with that as the baseline, right? The extreme between the haves and the have-nots is extreme. Watching billionaires become close to trillionaires and watching the extreme rise of wealth, it's an extreme. If we look at the diversity in terms of how we see politics, extreme. I live in Canada. You guys are both in the US. Extreme differences. We are and still will be neighbors, but it seems like there's these extremes. And I think consumer behavior, and I think relationships that consumers have with businesses is going to be more and more extreme. More choices, more opportunities, other places to go. Look at things like the third-party marketplaces that we saw emerging first on Amazon, but of course in places like Shopify and now beyond that. And even if you think about it from the taxonomy standpoint, and John, you talked about conspiracy theorists. I was very moved not that long ago, a couple of weeks back, by, I think the article was in The Atlantic, where conspiracy theorists are rebranding themselves as truth seekers. And I thought, like, what a fascinating and brilliant way to do this, right? Oh, you think you're a conspiracy theorist because you believe the earth is flat. Oh, no, no, I'm not a conspiracy theorist. I'm a truth seeker. Like, it really absolves people. And again, to me, these are all reinforcements of this idea of extremes. And even, you know, again, hat tip to my friend Harley Finkelstein and his partner Toby, that developed Shopify, a very massive business. But again, that's an extreme. This ability to sell something was typically expensive, even online. If we think back to things like Demandware and other e-com infrastructures, you had to have a pretty penny to really deploy that. And Shopify comes along and democratizes down to the individual wants to sell a little yarn bracelet. I mean, that's an extreme. And I believe that when we're thinking about the taxonomies and we're thinking about the environments, we have to be able to acknowledge these extremes. And I believe within them, it shouldn't be a panic. I think there's opportunity within that as well. But if you're not operating in that operating system of extremes, it gets really, really difficult. And again, it's a tough thing to say because you'd like to think, well, there's a level of normalcy. But it is totally extreme. Look at the vaccination rollouts. Look at how people perceive vaccines. We're brand shopping for vaccines at this point. We were just talking about this off air before. I mean, these are all extremes. And if we can't start with that baseline of a taxonomy, I think it's going to be really challenging moving forward.
So are you looking forward to the advent of data science in terms of helping us to define this taxonomy further and fine slice it? Or are there other ways that we should be looking at a taxonomy of extremes besides, you know, those who are almost obsessively searching for nostalgia versus those of us that can't wait to get to the latter parts of the 21st century?
Well, what's amazing in this world is with all of this digitization and access to data science, I mean, look at the debates we're having about things as basic as our health records or a vaccine passport. And so again, we have these big dreams of personalization, of databasing, of having all this information. But the truth is, at the end of the day, the file that's in my doctor's office is protein form. It's very, very physical. It's not protein form, but it's very, very physical.
Organic.
It's organic. And so I would love to have a conversation about where we could go with this. And I do think things like personalized medication, opportunities to go beyond your geography to get health. I mean, now we're seeing, I mean, just think about what we're seeing now. We're seeing the rise of telemedicine now. I mean, absurd when we really think about it. So to me, that area is prime. And I use the word prime, which I guess plays into the pun of the fact that Amazon wants to be very, very active in the healthcare space, Google as well, of course. But this is some of the stuff I spend a lot of time thinking about because I get very excited and I follow the links and I follow the information. But at the same time, I can look to my physical assets and realize nothing in that world has truly been digitized yet.
So we're going to have one of the world's authorities on the digitization of medicine coming up at the top of the hour, which is a great lead into that. Just wanted to ask you, I was curious, why is your book called Six Pixels of Separation? What is the six pixels notion, having not had a chance to read your book yet?
No worries. Well, that one came out a long time ago. So for those who don't know, I have a podcast and blog called Six Pixels of Separation. The podcast is the longest running business podcast in the history of podcasts. And the blog is one of the longer consistently running blogs, started in about 2003, 2004. And I wish I could take credit for that title, but it was a copywriter that had worked with us in my agency that I owned at the time. And we were talking about me being a speaker too at the time, developing my first keynote around how do we build our professional selves in these digital arenas? And we came up with this notion that in a world of 6 degrees of separation, and then we had 6 degrees of Kevin Bacon at the time, that we're now down to 6 pixels of separation, which is essentially means we're all connected. And so how do we connect as our brand, as an individual, to one another in a world where we're all connected? And again, when I reflect on it, you know, almost getting close to 20 years of doing it, the title still seems very fresh and relevant to me. So it's something I've stuck with, and I become the 6 pixels guy, which I'll take. It's fine.
Well, definitely, you know, in Gestalt psychology, you talk about incomplete information that creates intrigue and the desire for engagement. So 6 pixels definitely fits that theme. And as does the notion of connection, which I think is the subtext of everything we've been talking about thus far in our conversation. You know, I think that one of the big challenges for this reemergence is how we're all going to connect with people in terms of their unique needs that have been powerfully shaped by this collective experience of the last 15 months or so. So with that, I think I'll turn it back over to Brian for the capper of the half hour.
The capper. All right.
Capper. That's a great word.
I love it. Hey, Mitch, you just to kind of set the stage or whet the appetite, so to speak, for bringing you back on, if you're okay with that in the future. I believe you're an investor in Clubhouse.
I am not.
And oh, you're not. Okay. Well, you're certainly an intellectual investor in the Clubhouse movement. In that, you know, as a pioneer of podcasting, especially, you know, I mean, I got to tell you, I'm a big fan of what you've done, of course, across all of your media platforms, but you were early in the social audio movement, and you've been able to bring it to, I don't want to say the masses, but you've been able to humanize it in a way that made it both approachable and then also valuable for those who speak and for those who listen. And I guess so I just want to ask you a quick question around this. What does social audio look like today? Why was it so fast to gain momentum over the last several months? It when it's been trying to gain some steam since last April. And then what happens, you know, in the fall when the world starts opening up? And just high level, we can dive deeper sure. when you're back.
Yeah. Lots of questions. So Clubhouse is popular, there's no doubt, but I feel that there is this thing called Discord that was really going for quite some time and had a lot of momentum. While it might have sat in very peculiar verticals, primarily gamers and streamers and things like that. So that space is big. I mean, currently we're sitting in a world where there might be a $10 billion valuation and possible acquisition of Discord to Microsoft. We'll see how that plays out. You know, Clubhouse comes along and everyone gets very excited. So you're right. There is this notion of, well, we're home. There's not a lot of travel. We're hanging out. We can connect. And so audio is a great function in a world where some of us are zoomed out. And I don't know about you, but, oh, I'm going on with Brian and Joe. I have to set up the ring light. I have to do the other stuff, cover the lights, you know, make sure I shave, look pretty good. I want to look present. I want to be here, have a good non-virtual background for you. Versus I can be on and it's audio and I don't have to shave or put on any makeup or do that whole thing. So there is that component of it. But I think the bigger story here is just live. Live creates a lot of energy. And so if you think about in relation to music, and I spent a lot of time in the music business, and I'm sure John can appreciate this, there are moments in time where we want to listen to the album, the recorded work that the band toiled on for editing and mastering and hours and hours and hours to get the song just right. But then we also want to go see the band live. And we want things to be a bit crazy and a bit off the rails and have that experience, that communal experience. And as big as podcasting is and was and continues to grow, look no further than Spotify and deals like Joe Rogan and on and on and on, that live component, that energy of it was never there. And this adds into that. And the question that we're going to have to really be thinking about going forward is this idea of social audio, is it a destination? We're going to go on Clubhouse, or is it a feature like Twitter Spaces, like what might happen with LinkedIn, like what might happen with Slack, like what might happen with all the other companies, Facebook, et cetera, that have come forward and said they're building this out. So will it be that you go to Twitter, or will it be that you leave a voice message as you can currently in Twitter and it's a feature? And so as we click back into some form of normalcy, the question will be, how much of an appetite do consumers have for audio that is pre-recorded, and or how much more appetite might they have for live? And I think the answer is, like with everything else, it's going to be both. Everything is with, not instead of. This idea that one will crush the other, that one makes the other look old, to me is very antiquated. I think people will love listening to music, but they also love going to see live shows. And this is really that. Now, why it took so long is fascinating to me also, because usually it goes in the form of text, images, audio, video, based off of the data and the pipes and how much they can do it. And so it's wild that for some reason we had live video before live audio in a strange way in terms of popularity. And so perhaps it's just a correction of us seeing what this moment is. But for someone like me and someone like both of you, it should be really exciting because the opportunity to go on live, like I do 3 live radio hits every week, and you got to be hot on the mic coming out of the gates early on a Monday morning for me. But it's great to be able to spend that week working a little bit, getting in some reps, speaking live. I mean, I think the ability of a leader to stand up and cogently communicate to an audience is probably one of the greatest skill sets that anyone can have, not just a leader. And platforms like Clubhouse are really enabling that for people. So to me, it's very exciting because, hey, instead of renting that theater and having you as a guest on my podcast and we invite all of our friends, we can do that live and on the fly now in the virtual world. And that's really dynamic from my perspective.
Wow. Well, hey, everybody.
I have 3 quick reactions to that.
All right, John, go for it.
The public speaking issue, as we know, fear of public speaking is equaled only by the fear of skydiving. But if you take away the notion of being seen and it's only talking, it takes a lot of the social stress out of the situation, which, you know, enables it. So that's thought number one. Thought number two is it goes back to McLuhan, right? McLuhan talked about cool versus hot media and the notion of audio as a tribal experience, you know, sitting around the campfire and telling stories as opposed to a Zoom-like experience, which is much more in the, you know, kind of hot literary, you know, more information than you can possibly digest in a given moment, speaks to the notion of different media. And then finally, it's about belonging, right? So Clubhouse means you belong to a club. I don't particularly ever want to belong to Twitter or to a Twitter manifestation. I might like the audio part, but to be part of a club, to start a club, to moderate a club, to own a club, everyone wants to be a club owner, right? That's very cool. So those are my 3 little thoughts.
Yeah, I mean, I think ultimately there are many people who feel like community, like Twitter is their community or their Facebook private group is their community. So I think overall it's true, but it does. It has good branding, a great cachet, unicorn status, and a lot of people really excited. And sometimes you just hit it at the right moment in time. And it seems like this could be a catalyst to see how the feature set of live audio gets integrated into our social lives.
Yeah, it's well said. In fact, Mitch, I can't wait to have you back to talk more about this. And then the role of what we learn from the humanization of, let's say, audio and intimacy, and how we can take from that a more present, a more, let's just say, a more unified and a more human network in digital, as digital becomes more and more pervasive in the real world. So Mitch, with that, thank you so much for joining us. Such a pleasure to listen to you and learn from you.
Well, anytime, you know where to find me, and nice seeing you both.
Cheers, Mitch. Wow. Hey, so John, I tell you, we always learn so much from our guests, and it's just wonderful. I was thinking about how long I've known Mitch now, and I think it's now, it's got to be 13 or 14 years. But it is, it's incredibly refreshing when you know someone that long and they constantly impress you with their thinking and their mannerism and just also their approachability. And so someone like Mitch to join us today and help us is always a pleasure. So I'll turn it over to you, Mr. Kao, to introduce our next guest.
We are in for a treat. We have Dr. Edward Kirsch, better known to all of us, I believe, as Ed. And, you know, you've heard the expression, a doctor's doctor. In my humble opinion, Ed is a doctor's doctor's doctor. And I say this based partly on the facts. He's had a long and distinguished medical career, cardiology specialization. Most recently, he is the medical director for home health at Sutter Care at Home, but that was preceded by being medical director for telehealth at Sutter Care at Home. So there's a probably a story there. And Ed is very much at the forefront of the digitization of healthcare services. He is an advisor to various ventures that are in that field. And also, just on a personal note, I have to Ed was my father's medical student when my dad was teaching at the State University of New York, wow. Cal State Medical Center. And then I got to relate to Ed. So there's a three-generational kind of relationship going on here, which is quite special. And I'm happy to acknowledge that to all of the people out in the internet, because it makes this conversation extra special. So with that, Ed, welcome. Great to see you.
Well, thank you, John. And let me add to that another generation, which will be your daughter.
That's very true. My daughter actually hung out with you last summer.
That's right.
One thing I neglected to mention is that Ed has a long history of generosity in terms of donating his expertise. And the San Francisco Free Clinic, among many others, is the beneficiary of his knowledge. And my daughter, Emmeline, had a chance to shadow Ed when he was doing his rounds at the Free Clinic last summer. So four generations. You know, Ed, the Chinese custom is that if there are five generations under one roof, the emperor is required to visit that household.
Oh.
Now, that's an out-of-date concept, but I relate that because four generations is already pretty special. So there's so many things we could talk about.
Yes.
I think, and hopefully we'll get to all of them, but the thing I'm most curious about at this point is, what are you doing in the whole kind of telehealth, virtualization of health services area? How does that relate to your current medical directorships? How has the pandemic accelerated, if it has, or influenced people's receptivity to virtual services, the acceleration of those services? And then maybe we can dive into some of the specific stuff you're doing around the entrepreneurial stuff.
Wow. that's a whole lot to talk about. Well, I just want to jump back to something that your previous guest said, which had to do with the digitization of medicine. And you and I had a discussion about wellness, and you were very interested in this topic. And so I want to throw out a blanket statement, which is you can't digitize wellness. Wellness is a state of mind, and it's multifactorial. And maybe we can talk about that some more a little bit later. Telemedicine or telehealth, and both names are used interchangeably, has come to the forefront with the pandemic. There's no doubt about it. And there are really two forms of telemedicine. The first is the virtual visit, the Zoom type of thing that you were talking about. And I will tell you a little anecdote. About a year ago, I got dressed one morning and was going to go to the San Francisco Free Clinic to do some consultations on some of their patients. And as I was walking out the door, the phone rang and the medical director said to me, "You know, I don't think it's a good idea for you to come in today. You know, the pandemic, the shutdown had just started." And I said, "Well, okay." And then the next thing you know, we were doing consultations over Zoom. And it's a very interesting phenomenon to actually do patient interactions over Zoom. There are actually a lot of benefits in it. And I was thinking about this just yesterday. One of the things is that you sort of get to see yourself as the provider. I'm watching myself as I interact with the patient. And so I get a little idea of what the patient is seeing. And then I also see the patient's interaction. So there's an additional dimension in virtual health and in doing virtual health visits. Now, I think virtual health visits are here to stay. And the reason is pretty obvious, and that is that Medicare, the CMS and all of the other healthcare providers are going to pay for it. They see the benefit of virtual visits. Patients definitely see the benefit of it. You know, I don't have to get up and I don't have to go across town. I can do it right here from my home and have an interaction with my physician. So there are tremendous benefits there. So one aspect is the virtual visit. The other is what we call RPM, which means remote patient monitoring. And that's something that I've been interested in over the years. This started for me about 10 years ago when I was what was called the heart failure champion for the hospital that I was working at. And we started to work on this issue of telemonitoring patients at home, particularly heart failure patients, and following them and trying to keep them out of the hospital and keep them on the right medications and understand what was going on with them. So RPM is now a very popular thing. And I would say there are more vendors than I can count on my fingers and toes right now of people who are creating platforms that we can use. And what we do with the RPM is we monitor blood pressure, we monitor heart rate, we monitor oxygen saturation, we monitor the daily weight of the patient. We can even monitor from the home the EKG. So all of these things can be combined onto one platform, sent every day. The patient does this. All of these different devices, by the way, now are use Bluetooth, are Bluetooth enabled. And so the patient has a central station. You can have the bathroom scale in the bathroom next to the toilet, and the patient steps on it in the morning, and then that data goes over by Bluetooth to the platform, and then that gets sent out to the monitoring station. So remote patient monitoring is a way of detecting changes or deterioration in a patient's clinical status, and that enables us to interact then, usually virtually, with the patient to forestall any further problems. So that has been what I have done over the past several years. And in terms of Sutter, in my I retired from clinical practice a few years ago, as you know, John. But I have been directing visiting nurses in their management of patients in the home care setting. And it's a very gratifying job, and one that I've been able to throw myself into.
Fantastic. So I want to get into RPM a little bit more, because my understanding, well, I actually just put in an order for a continuous glucose, non-invasive glucose monitor, which I believe is going to show up. I'm in the beta program, because I'm curious to see how fluctuations occur in terms of a 24-hour rhythm. And I'm sure there will be many, many other ways of generating information remotely. And my question is, how far is this going to go? And to what extent is data science going to get us new patterns of, you know, how patients are doing, the good, the bad, and the ugly of it? And at what point is there almost too much data relative to information, right? I mean, the thing is, you go, yeah, you have an office visit, and the seasoned doctor looks at you and immediately has pattern recognition. But now we're talking about, you know, Kevin Kelly, who's a pundit on digital matters, talks about the transition from events to flows. And I find that very intriguing in many areas. And in medicine, you know, still, you know, I'm in the every 6 month doctor contact mode, where, you know, I provide some information, I get some blood work and so forth and so on, which is an event. But I personally am looking forward to the flow time, but I'm wondering how you see it evolving, what it's likely to look like.
Okay. Well, there are two levels on which it's evolving. And the first and most important is what you're talking about right now, which is self-management. You're interested in your own data and looking at your own data and taking actions based on your own data. And that's the key in remote patient monitoring, to be able to give that feedback loop directly to the patient and then create, do it in such a way that the patient has actionable data and that they can then take action. Of course, they do it with the advice of their physician usually, but you can educate somebody about that situation. So patient self-management is an extremely important thing. In your situation, what you're talking about is, oh, I want to know what my sugar is doing and so on and so forth. What you're interested in is prevention. You're trying to prevent diabetes by monitoring your blood sugars and looking at that whole situation. And one of the best things we can do in terms of preventing the disease is find out that we have a proclivity toward a particular disease and then take the steps that we can do to avoid that disease or to avoid the manifestations of it. So on the individual level, we have patient self-management. Now let's talk on the population level. And most big healthcare systems have a department that is now called population health. And they are looking at their population of patients and trying to devise a scheme for how to manage those patients properly. Now, Kaiser out here in California has really been at the forefront of population health, because what they've been able to do is collect data on thousands and hundreds of thousands of patients. Want to know what kind of job are we doing with our diabetics? Well, there's all the data, and then they can take that data that they have accumulated through remote patient monitoring, or the same thing in hypertension, and look at that, and then they can decide, okay, we're doing a good job on this, let's continue to do that, or we're not doing a good job, we need to change what we're doing. So remote patient monitoring can have an impact on two levels. First, as I said, being patient self-management, and the second being population health.
And, you know, there's a great concern about the rising costs of healthcare in the United States. We spending more money and getting less results, you know, certainly compared to, you know, like a country like Singapore spends about half as much per capita on healthcare, and they seem to be no less healthy than we are. So is RPM going to help, and these changing patterns of virtual versus face-to-face meetings? I mean, in the long run, let's say in the next couple of decades, will it reshape healthcare so it'll be more efficient, and will it also reduce the cost of healthcare at a kind of national level?
Well, I think you've just struck on it. Will it reshape healthcare so it will be more efficient? I think that's the direction that we need to go. Let's face it, in the United States, we have the most expensive healthcare and the poorest outcomes. I mean, the pandemic has just shown us that. We're the world leader in cases of COVID-19 and in our death rates. And you can look at things like maternal and child health and infant mortality, and you'll see the same types of data. So, without getting too political about it, our healthcare system is broken, and it needs to be fixed, but it needs to be fixed at the core. And remote patient monitoring is not going to fix our healthcare system at the core. It's a peripheral. But once we get a coordinated healthcare system with everybody enrolled in a healthcare system and a single payer, then remote patient monitoring can be applied across the populations to give us the clues that we need in terms of outcomes and how people are doing. In terms of cost, you asked about that, and one of the listeners also sent a question about how will this how does this cost the patient. Remote patient monitoring, when it's done by a third-party vendor, usually costs around $80 per month. That's what they charge for the service and all the peripherals. So there are two aspects of it. One is the actual leasing of the equipment that they give to the patient, and then the service that goes with that to monitor the patient. But remote patient monitoring doesn't have to go on forever. You can transition the patient. You start them out with a remote patient monitoring system, and then you can transition that patient to their own blood pressure device, to their own pulse oximeter, to their own scale, because now they've learned how to monitor themselves. So in terms of the initial cost, you know, $80 a month is not a phenomenal amount of money when you consider our healthcare costs these days. Being able to move the patient to a self-monitoring system, then self-monitoring doesn't cost anything. So that's the objective.
It's just the startup costs of getting people up to speed, which pays for itself probably many fold very quickly. You know, it's ironic. What you describe as the situation of the healthcare system, you could also equally apply to our education system, our national defense. You know, we're spending more money than anybody else, but you know, right. It's not clear that we're best prepared for the 21st century. That's a whole separate topic. You know, I wondered if you wanted to say a word or two about LifeWave or the other.
Sure. Yeah. Well, a couple of the things that I've worked on over the years in what I guess you would call med technology or biotechnology. First was a little device called a Live Core. And let me just show you this. This is a little Live Core device, and you place your fingers on it like this, and it records your EKG. And then that EKG can be transmitted as a PDF to the provider. So one of the things I noted, talking about the San Francisco Free Clinic, I noticed that every patient who, and let me just say, San Francisco Free Clinic only sees uninsured patients. So if you have insurance, they're going to send you someplace where you can get healthcare, like San Francisco General or whatever. And so we see a lot of uninsured patients, a lot of people in the immigrant population. And in that population, palpitations, sensations in the heart are very common. And in order to figure that out, you would have to send the patient to the hospital to have them put on a cardiac monitor. One of the things I noticed when I was at the clinic was every patient had a smartphone. Everyone has a smartphone. And even the 80-year-old Mongolian lady who was here visiting her family, she had a smartphone, or her daughter had a smartphone. And so I said, you know what, let's get these devices for the clinic. And the AliveCore company donated a bunch of devices, and we've been using these regularly, hundreds and hundreds of times that we've used them, and saved thousands and thousands of dollars for the free clinic by just using this little device. Now, the LifeWave device is also called CardioConnect. And that's another very interesting device. It is, again, about this size, and you place it on the chest just here, or actually we do it in the right chest, the The image is backwards on my screen. We put it on the chest, and it's a pulsed radar device. And what it does is it measures the amount of fluid in your lung. So, John, you know, when you're examining a patient with heart failure, you want to listen to their lungs to see, right? You want to percuss, and you want to listen to their lungs to hear if you can hear what are called rales, the sound of fluid in the lungs. And that's very unreliable, actually. But this little device, you put it on the chest wall, and it gives you a reading and tells you exactly how much fluid is in the lungs. This is very important in patients with heart failure, because that's the thing that drives patients with heart failure to the hospital is they get short of breath, and they get short of breath because they get fluid in their lungs. So that's another device I've been working on. The other company that I've been working with recently is a company called Eco. And Eco has an electronic digital stethoscope, which is combined with artificial intelligence. And again, I've been using that with the free clinic in these virtual consultations. I sent an Eco device over to the clinic. And when the patient is there, the technician at the clinic will put it on the patient's chest, record all the different heart sounds and murmurs, and then shoot it over to me as an MP4. And then I can sit here with my headphones and listen to their heart, which has been one of the criticisms of the virtual healthcare visit is, oh, well, I can't really examine the patient. Well, actually, technology is now helping us examine the patient a bit. So, Those are some of the companies that I've worked with, and it's very gratifying to see them. But again, technology is not going to replace healthcare. It can be an adjunct. It can help us provide better healthcare, but we can't replace the interaction between the patient and the provider, the physician, the nurse. That's still at the core of what we do.
That's the part of the secret sauce. The
right.
It's the inspiration. So, yeah. Listen, mindful of the time, I want to make sure that we throw over to Brian, because I know he's been looking very thoughtful over there and probably has more questions to pose than we have time.
Please go ahead.
Most definitely. Thank you, John. And thank you, Dr. Kirsch, for all of your insights.
Sure.
And I could only imagine having you as a primary care physician, because you are you're so so thoughtful and kind and just approachable. And it's very welcoming. So thank you. I don't even know where to begin. I have so many questions. You know, one of the things that I often joke about, just for some context, I spent a lot of time thinking about the future of ... in every single industry and reverse engineering it so that those industries can then chart a path towards what that future looks like starting today. And in anything, whether it's teleworking, telecommuting, telemedicine, by its very nature just seems dated as a term in that now in a post-COVID world, it seems like remote is just going to be a natural part of our future in everything, learning, work, health. And I'm wondering what it is that healthcare providers need to embrace beyond just the transactional nature of telemedicine, right? So we're going to employ or deploy telemedicine platforms for our patients. What is it that they need to do for remote healthcare to become part of healthcare, where we don't even have to use terminology like telemedicine? Hopefully that makes sense.
Well, it does make sense. And I think that I can only look to my sons for the answer to this. Because both of them, they're obviously younger, and folks in the younger generation, they take to it in a flash. One of my sons had a rash. What did he do? He took a picture of it with his cell phone and he sent it to the dermatologist at his hospital and had an interaction that way. He didn't have to take a half a day off from work. to go and have the dermatologist look at it. So it's more what the public, what the patient, what the consumer of healthcare is going to want to do. And that is going to drive the behavior of the providers of healthcare. You know, when you look at a doctor's profile on the internet these days, one of the questions down below, you know, accepting new patients, provides telemedicine. That has now become integral to the provision of healthcare. I believe Kaiser published some data this year where they went before the pandemic, I think something like 7 or 8% of their visits were done virtually. And during the pandemic and now toward the end of it, like 75% of their visits are done virtually. Mm. So I think it's going to be consumer driven. And the physicians, if they're going to want to keep their patients, are going to have to get on board. And fortunately, the insurers, the people who pay for the healthcare services, seem to also be on board. And so that is, to coin the term, that's the intersection where that's the intersection for success in this world of telemedine.
Well said. And if I may, we're out of time, but I have to squeeze one more question, if that's okay with you.
Go ahead, sure.
I think about, hopefully our producer behind the scenes doesn't scold me for sharing this, but he had an issue a while back before COVID where he had an app that, like Uber, the doctor came to him. And it was, I thought, gosh, you know, the Uber of medicine and also remote medicine is going to be fantastic. That's just an observation. But my question for you is this. I was doing some research yesterday about the future of work, and it sort of comes on the heels of this article that I wrote on how in the post-pandemic world, every company is going to need to become a digital health company. And that we saw the rise of... as you said earlier, the rise of wellness really start to accelerate or escalate in employee engagement for all companies. And I wanted to share some stats with you and get your take on how companies can become health companies moving forward. We say at Salesforce that every company has to become a digital company. And now we're also starting to look at the importance of health and wellness in all companies too. And so these numbers are really mind-blowing. 77% of people say that they would share their work activity in exchange for safe working environment. 69% would share medical information in exchange for a safe working environment. 60 would share their location history, and 56% would share who they interact with in order to get a safe working environment. So to me, it says that health and wellness at work is now becoming sort of in alignment with what you were saying with proactive care and prevention. So how can companies also play a role in promoting health and wellness at work?
Well, what we're looking at is how do we replace what used to be called the employee health service? You know, big companies had an employee health service that unfortunately got transformed more into a police force than actually something that was helping the employees. So that's one issue. How do we transform that concept into something that the employee trusts and feels free to share that personal health information with their employer? That's a difficult thing. And you know, you always have this workman's compensation thing hanging over everything. And so that's a very challenging thing. The point you brought up about the doc on the cell phone is also important, because most of those services are anonymous. You get a doctor somewhere, you know, it's like urgent care. You have urgent care on your phone. Mm-hmm. Still people relate to an individual. And so in virtual healthcare, for virtual healthcare to be successful, it has to be your doctor or your healthcare system that you have trust in. Again, that's where the technology can help that, but it can't replace that. The last part of your question, though, I'm not sure how to answer. It has more to do, I think, with wellness and with how people perceive their own state of health at any given time. That's something I'd have to give a lot more thought to. I just can't answer that off the top of my head.
Well, maybe that's an on-ramp for another conversation.
Okay, sure. I like how you think, John. I would welcome that in a heartbeat. Pun intended.
Well, the whole issue, and I'll just throw this little concept out, is that occupational satisfaction is also a main driver of your health and wellness. And it's one of the multiple factors that goes into wellness, and not only physical, not only emotional, but also your physical wellness. So I'll certainly be happy to come back and talk to you about the concept of wellness and how, and again, the intersection of physical and emotional well-being.
We welcome it.
You've had such a storied career and a breadth of perspective that I think that would be welcome. And also, you remind us just by being here what great medicine is all about. So thank you very much for being here, Ed.
Thank you. It was such a pleasure to interact with you guys today. I really had a great time. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Just amazing. Just amazing. Well, John, that brings us to the conclusion of yet another fascinating a fascinating episode of Intersections. So with that said, I know we're out of time and we're about to get kicked off the platform because we're hitting the end. So I will just say thank you for joining us this week. We will see you next Thursday at 10:30 a.m. Pacific. Do follow us on the social medias. Do tune in to Intersections Live for past episodes because you will be blown away like we have been blown away. Also join our, please join our Zealous space. This is actually the new startup from our producer, Gregarious. And we'll have him, what we should do is bring him on next Thursday at the beginning of the show so that we can talk about what this means, what this looks like for Intersections and how this is going to grow our community together and what that means for everybody involved. And then also with that said, we are so close to getting our website both updated and also our newsletter launched because they're one and the same project. We have a new person on staff who will help us get this going, which is a reminder to me to follow up with her after this. So with that said, thank you so much. We will see you next week.